Welcome to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Vago Maradian here at the Association of the United States Army's annual meeting and trade show in Washington, D.C. Our coverage here is sponsored by AM General, Elbit Systems of America, General Motors Hydrotech, L3 Technologies, and Leonardo DRS. And we're over here at Lockheed Martin right now to talk to a retired United States Army Major General, Jim Rogers, who is the Vice President for Army Programs Integration at Lockheed Martin. Sir, thanks very much for the time.
Well, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
So what are, you know, you guys have a vast stand here with a wider array of products, I think, than almost anybody else has. You're on two of the future helicopter, future vertical lift programs. You're partnered with Sikorsky on one. You're partnered with Bell Helicopter on their Valor. But talk to us a little bit about what are the top things you guys are highlighting. You know, we've heard a lot of messages from Army leadership. Where are you guys making the investment? Where do you have the new products that you're engaging with senior leaders on, senior leaders with this week?
Yeah, so we take our lead from the chief, and so he laid them out, and quite honestly, we're well positioned for all of those. So if you think of it, long-range precision fires, we're on the team that has been drawn down to two, where we're competing for that particular program. We have the ATACMs, and so we're actually service life extending the ones that are currently on the shelf. And we're working toward making that LRPF the way the Army wants it, in accordance with the regulations and priorities. Future vertical lift, as you can imagine, you know, you look behind you, you see the future vertical lift light possibility. We as you know, Sikorsky is a part of us now, and we're partnered with Boeing, so we're looking forward to that. And as you mentioned, for both the what they call the Cape Set 3, which is a replacement for like the Blackhawk. We're partnered both with the Sikorsky Boeing team and then also on the Valor with the Bell and Lockheed Martin team. So it gives us an opportunity with our breadth and depth to help both teams out. And that's kind of what's important about that. We're also doing some what they call MSHORAD, Maneuver SHORAD, with our Q-53 that we've had in the field for since 2010.
And that's the short range air defense.
That Q-53 radar is what we fielded in 39 months to the warfighters, and they've been using it ever since, and they love it. We're working on some different projects with the Army to optimize that a little better and see a few more things so that they can use it for different missions, which is what the chief's all about. Let's get what we have, modernize it, and use it for what we can, because we don't know when the next battle is going to be. And so we're working on a miniature hit-to-kill, which is basically a small hit-to-kill. You know, PAC-3, MSC, THAAD, all of those are hit-to-kill technologies. We've shrunk that down, and hopefully we will be able to use that for CRAM in what the Army is calling their next generation of protecting the force and the FOBs, the forward operating bases.
And that's mortar, artillery, short-range stuff that's going to be coming at soldiers because enemies are benefiting from the technological revolution just like we are. Talk to us a little bit on the radar side of things, because you have one of the cooler gigantic rotating displays that are here at the show.
That's right. So that's the Q-53. And so it basically gives you 360-degree coverage. And so it does the counter ram and, you know, the artillery and the mortars. And so that is the technology that we're leaping off with for what we're in a competition right now with is the lower tier air missile defense sensor, which is the next generation radar, which will be able to look farther, detect farther, and track so that we can then use the kinetics of our mission system enhanced PAC-3 missile, which right now basically can outrange the radar.
When you're looking at some of the investment decisions you guys have been making, we were just talking to General Cavan, it was lovely seeing him again. This is a great old home week see all friends that you managed to cover over the years. You know, when it comes to making some of these investment decisions, it's a difficult budgetary environment. You know, we were talking about, you know, you've got to be nuts to think that we're totally out of the financial woods. Continuing resolutions are still the order of the day. There will be a big debate on the tax plans and all of this other stuff that's coming. How does that shape how you guys make these investment decisions? Because, you know, everybody would like to see more money, but it's not maybe not as robust as people would like to see. Chief already made it clear that the number one thing he's got to address is the readiness challenge in the force, even though he wants to drive acquisition programs ahead. How does that shape how you guys make your investment decisions as the world's largest defense contractor?
So first thing we do is we hear the requirements from our customers. And so the Army has said, I may not be able to modernize with the monies that I have, but for readiness purposes, I need to make them as capable as I can to fight the next war. And so what we're trying to do is work with them and then expand that with research and development. So we're spending quite a bit of research and development monies to help them to make sure they can get to their goal, step one. We also are looking, so we call them the big bets. We're looking at those things that we think are going to be important in the next 10 or 15 years that they're going to ask for. They have to. Directed energy, high energy lasers is one of them. You know, we've said that's 5 and 10 years down the road for a very long time. We think it's closer than that now than it's ever been. And so we're working on those type of projects. And the cyber and EW that we're working toward, for all systems, you just can't say I'm working on cyber and EW, because every platform that you have has to have it integrated in. And so we're working toward that with our customers, with the Army, trying to help them to ensure that that network is completely protected, because everything is a network now and it's all connected. Heck, your washer and your dryer are connected. So just think of that and think of all the systems that you have to protect in a very layered defense way so that we have the advantage, not them.
That's certainly going to be an interesting future where your appliances have a mind of their own.
Yeah.
We're there. Laundry is a weapon. In all seriousness, speaking about long-range precision fires, and some of this is treaty limited in terms of the distance of some of these systems, but almost every one of the contractors working on these systems have indicated we can achieve significantly greater range. Are you guys, talk to us a little bit about some of the longer range systems you guys are working on a little bit. In the event that, there is an abrogation of treaty and things change, do you have things in the pipeline that'll give you that greater reach in the event that is necessary in a conventional basis?
Yeah, so obviously we're following the INF treaty, and that's what the Army has told us to do, and we're doing that. And so is there capabilities, though, that can extend beyond that treaty? Absolutely. And we've had discussions, but it's just discussions because of the treaty. And so I think, we'll see what happens in the future if that changes, but we're ready to attack that change if the service decides they want to do that.
Is there any difficulty or challenge for you guys being on all, both of these teams? There's a concern, every side has a concern at a time like this when, your partner buys a helicopter company in which he's got a stake for another guy. The concern always is you guys will make certain make-buy decisions based on that and favor the one that's more profitable. I've covered the defense industry for a while, and these calculations are part of the mix. How do you guys ensure that everybody stays a happy customer here, ultimately, as the person who has significant interest with a bunch of other contractors as a supplier, but then also the owner of a company on which its survival will depend on the victory of a product, for example?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And so one of the reasons I joined Lockheed Martin is because of the high morals and ethics that they hold. We have firewalls that we have and we abide by. We also have merchant suppliers, what we call it, for some of the mission system things that can work on both. But as soon as they understand that any competition sensitive, they're immediately read into that program and can no longer work on the other program. So we're very strict on the sharing of data. But for those things that we can be merchant suppliers on, we are. And that helps both teams. And it helps the service.
Sir, thanks very, very much. We really appreciate it and look forward to talking to you again soon.
Thank you. I appreciate it.